2 years ago, I got my S85 to start on an SCS Delta standalone DME with a modified harness. And it was an amazing feeling. But since then, I wanted to upgrade to an MK60 E5 DSC setup, and the only way to do that is to have a PT CAN communication between the DSC and the DME. Unfortunately, you couldn't do that with an SCS Delta setup, so I've gone back to the stock MSS65. But how do I get to run that on standalone? This video will show you as concisely as humanly possible everything that you need to know to do a standalone MSS65 setup, including wiring, pinouts, fuel, EKP, CAN bus, and the links and the descriptions on how to go about acquiring the software and the licenses to flash out your EWS and even do a stock tune. If you look down into the description of this video, you will see a plethora of information, including pinouts, part numbers of connectors and seals and pins, websites, links to download, and it has everything you need in order to do this for under $100. All right, all the tools and materials that you're gonna need are listed here. It's good to get some alligator clips. We've got a Fenersi 2C53T. This is just a multimeter. Anything to measure voltage is fine. Got some harness tape, some cutters. I've got a WeatherPak connector crimper that crimps in a nice W pattern here. And I've got wire strippers there, so I can strip all my wires that I need. Over here, I've got all of my pins and connectors that are needed here. I've got my housing. I've got my housing lock. I've got my X6003 here. I've got my X6001 in the gray and the X6002 in the black. Those are the pins for the X6001 and 2. These are the larger gauge pins for the 6001 and 2 as needed, and these are the pins for the X6003, which are basically powers and grounds. Over here, we've got our EKP relay with both connectors here, connectors and pins. I got lucky enough to get one of these, but all of the pins, connectors, and part numbers are going to be down in the description. Over here, we have our accelerator pedal. We've got our seals, our connector, and our pins for the accelerator pedal. And then finally, as optional, we've got terminal blocks and ground lugs for connecting our powers and grounds to the chassis. And lest we forget, the OBD2 connector with its pins and two locks. These are going to be very important for us to be able to connect our cable from the computer to the chassis. You're also going to need a laptop and a Bimmer Geeks cable. This is a K plus D CAN cable that plugs directly into the OBD2 port. And it also has a USB to plug into the computer. Starting off with the DME. Most harnesses that you'll get have the harness and the DME connected. You'll have, this is the X6004567, and that is actually connected to everything on the engine. It's connected to the injectors and the coils. This is what we really are concerned about wiring right now. This is what our X6001, 2, and 3 are connected to. Essentially, it goes to powers, grounds, and the chassis. On the X6002, you've got one power. It's on pin 1. That's it. That is your switched power. That is what, when you turn the key on, that needs to have power. When you turn the key off, that does not get power. Here is our housing with the X6003 connector. As you can see here, I've already got my powers and grounds wired up. The grounds are on 4, 5, and 6 for grounds, and pin 1 and 2 for positive power. Now I have these connected together, and that's all going to this as well, which is also power. We'll get to that in a second. This is our main power node here. This is a junction where all the powers need to go. That is when it receives battery power, it starts turning on the main relay and all that stuff once connected to switch power. I actually have a little, just like a little metallic node here that I can use my alligator clip to do testing and connect that to power, and then I can activate everything all up. This is my main power for the car on this particular E31. But that is what actually activates and turns on most of the main power for the relay, and nothing else gets powered on until you switch on the switched power, which is, like I said, on the X6002 pin 1. Grounds are similar. Now, the main ground here, this is a main power ground. This is a ground that goes from the chassis to the engine itself, and that literally is to allow the starter to start, but also allows the engine to be a ground for itself. So the engine needs to be grounded to the chassis. There's no doubt about that. The DME wiring and harness grounds, very simple. Again, as part of the harness, this two big thick ground wires go to your ground lug right there. And you're also going to have a ground on your X6003, pin 4, 5, and 6 right there, if you can see them. Those all get tied together and go to a ground as well, which all needs to be, of course, tied together. This is a fuse panel right here that is already fused. So once you put your power to it, everything is going through this fuse box and this one as well before it starts going to all the places where it needs to go on the rest of the car, like the injectors and the coils and so on and so forth. So everything is already fused. If you'd like to fuse it again with another bigger fuse, you can do that. You just need to make sure that you got that fuse sized accordingly. And then just to identify what all of this is here, I wanted to show you this, as explained earlier, is your power connection node. This is your main relay. This is your off the main relay. These are fuses for all the things on the engine. This here is your injection relay, your injectors, and that gets fused over here. So the power to the main injector relay comes from the 6011 connector. Let's talk about that really quick. Now, power comes in from here. You have a little power here that's going to this fuse. This is a 10 amp fuse. That fuse comes back out right to here. This is powered on once you apply your switched power, turns the main relay on. This here is a ground switching for this injector relay. That way, so if you were to connect the ground there, going through that 10 amp fuse and into the injector relay, you are now turning on the injector relay once you apply switched power. This here is your 6011 connector. This connector has the following pins assigned to it, as shown down in the description below. Take a look and see exactly what these wires are and why they matter for you. Also on the 6011 is your start wire. This is the infamous black wire with a yellow stripe. This is power supplied to the starter. We're going to end up using a dedicated alligator clip for this effort, and we're just going to put this directly to power when everything else is powered on and ready to go, including fuel. This here is the X6011 connector. As you can see, it's fully populated with wires. I might have just considered myself lucky that I got a version of the ECU that had these connectors already part of it, and then they just clipped them off so I could just tap into the wires. This here are our 6 wires for the accelerator pedal. The accelerator pedal has 2 potentiometers, 2 powers, 2 grounds, and 2 signals for redundancy purposes. We've also got pin 1 and pin 14 for our can high and low. We've got this guy, which is our fuel output. This is pin 22 on the X6001. And then finally, we've got our tack. I did not wire the tack because it wasn't required to start, but that is the black wire right here. So that's really all you need on the X6001 in order to get this thing started. Now let's talk about our OBD2 wiring. OBD2 has some very simple, very standard wiring harness that ends up going to this connector. For the S85, the X6001 pin 1 and 14 go to the can high and low on the OBD2 connector. You really should be using a twisted pair. In this case, for prototyping, I don't really care about that. I just am trying to get it to connect, and then when I do the formal version, it'll be twisted pair to make for better connections. In this case, we've got 2 powers on pin 1 and 16. We've got 2 grounds on pin 4 and 5. And then we've got our can high and low. I typically like to use green as can low and yellow as high. So think about green is the grass, pretty low, and yellow is the sun way up high. So that's how I do it. And that goes into pins 6 and 14. And now that's it. This is all you need to do in order to wire. This particular connector is very useful for me because it actually has little installation holes on it, so you can install and put it wherever you want. You can keep it inside of here, or you can keep it inside of the glove box or under the steering column, wherever you'd like. Before you do anything like this, you always need to make sure you have a battery charger hooked up. Always, 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 always. And always make sure that it's running at least 12.5 volts on the charging. Okay, so we've got everything connected and hooked up. I've got my licenses here, which you guys can't even use. Don't even bother trying to pause it here. These licenses are for my cars, my ECUs, my DMEs. It's all coded to that, so you guys can't do anything there. But it is good to have it saved as a notepad file. That way you know where they are anytime you need it. Here I've got the actual MSS6X flasher. It's 1.0.0.3, and this is what we're going to use to actually do the DME flashing. Here is the binary modification tool. In the modification tool, this is where we do our throttle position sensor modifications, our throttle adjustments, we do our cold start deletes, our primary cat deletes, EWS delete, EVAP, all that type of stuff can all be done in that tool. Now let me show you exactly how it's done. Before you do any reading or flashing of the DME, just make sure that your COM port is plugged into COM1 and that your latency for the timer is at 1 millisecond. It usually is about 16, but you got to change it to 1. Now you want to identify your DME and then just do a read full flash. For the MSS65, you need to read a full flash. It's going to take about an hour to an hour and 15 minutes to finish. Once you finish pulling the file, I want you to reload that file. It shows that it's loaded there. And then you want to go to advanced to go flash RSA bypass on the file that you just downloaded. Now in the binary modification tool, you want to click browse to load the one that you just saved with the RSA bypass. Don't forget to click no if you're using a normal cable. Now you want to click all of the things, including the EWS delete, which is the most important thing there, and then apply your changes. This is where you need to get your license. When you go to action, generate license request. You can see here that I have an issue here because I've already got it under a certain license, so I can't request a new license under this DME. But when you do that, you're paying about $100 or £75 to get your own license. Then you can use that license, copy it in, and you can flash your DME by going to write changes. Now that we've done the flashing, we need to confirm that the flash actually took. And what you do is you not only apply power to the ECU, but once you apply that switched power, that X6002 pin 1, that's when the throttle body should start to actuate, and you know that this thing will start as long as it's getting its fuel and as long as it's getting its power to the ignition relay. Okay, now when it comes to fuel, you have a couple of different options. There is an X6001 pin 22, it's a green wire, that goes directly to this connector on the EKP relay. Part number is down in the description. So this EKP relay takes power and ground, fused power and ground. It uses this green wire as an opportunity for transmitting CAN information. And it outputs two different fuel pumps. So there's two powers and two grounds. Actually, there's three powers on this one. But there's two fuel pumps inside of the E60M5, and it's self-regulated. So there's a regulator on the output of the pump inside the fuel tank. Here we've got our regulator in the engine bay, and it's adjustable, so we're gonna have to play with that. But we have a fuel pressure sensor that's part of this that also gets plugged into the X6001. It's three wires. I'll show you down in the overlay right here that you can see which pins they are. And that goes from the three pins on the actual fuel pressure sensor on the inlet side, on the after the fuel regulator, and that connects to the X6001 so that the ECU knows what the fuel pressure is going into the engine. Now, I don't have my fuel pressure sensor installed, but you don't really need it in order to start the engine. That's really what we're trying to do here is start the engine. We don't really care about it running well or anything like that. That type of diagnosing can be done later. Here we've got our main fuel line coming into our regulator that's regulated down, and it goes right into the fuel rail. CAN, EWS flashing. We have mechanically just about everything we need here, and I'm gonna just manually put fuel into the rail and just apply power, and then just, I guess, apply power to the starter and see if it works. So here's fuel. And now here is power to the ECU. And here is power to the starter. Zone, but it runs and starts. That's great. We can take it from there. Let me shut it off. Okay. Yeah, so this is not working anymore, so it's probably in some sort of limp mode, I'm guessing. It's running really rich because of the fuel that I had put in. It's probably running super rich, but I don't care. It's running. That means that the injectors are firing. It means that the coils are working. That means everything's working. So this is great, great news. And from here on out, it's going to be fine-tuning. Very, very exciting, guys. So, this is great. Now you guys know how to flash your EWS, you know how to get it hooked up, you know how to get it started, and even just rigging things up with alligator clips is okay for prototyping and just getting proof of concept. That's what I've been doing for 15 years, and I'm gonna continue to do it for the next 15. Guys, we got another cool episode coming up next where you guys get to see me play with spoilers on this thing. I got like four of them that I want to test out and see which one works the best. Maybe even get your vote on which one you like the best. Thanks a lot, guys, for watching. My name is Frank from Garageaholic, and I hope you learned something. Take it easy, guys. Later.